Welcome to Keith and the Girl. I'm Keith Malley.
I'm Hemda.
Hemda, it's this weekend and I'm visiting my mom in assisted living. A little nerve-wracking.
Are you nervous? Do you think sort of morbid thoughts as you get closer, or are you just kind of keeping it in the now?
Keeping it in the now. I know it's going to be the saddest thing. I know with dementia, she's going to be the worst I've seen her in my life. I know that. Other than that, I don't know what to do. You know, that's it. I'll be with all my siblings. Kyle's going to be there as well. I'm going to have better help on speed dial.
Excellent. Yeah.
This is what's happening. I'll try. I don't know if my dad's going to show up to any of the times we visit assisted living.
Oh, my God. Trigger.
Yeah.
But also support. So you're like, you have one of those, what do you call those Captain America shields right there? So it's coming at you. You got your better help. It's coming at you. You got your Kyle Ocasio.
Yeah. I picture him, my dad, saying in front of siblings, because he thinks, because of social norms, I have to engage with him, even though he, you know, flirted with my ex-wife. So I really just throw that in to see the guest look on their face. And but I picture him saying, son, do you have a second to talk? And me just saying, no, thanks. Or we could talk about my ex in front of all the siblings. We can do that. But we can't all of a sudden act like things are fine because mom's in a bad way.
Okay, I love this because, yes, you are living in the now when it comes to your mother. You're like, here's where we are. But with your father, you're fantasizing.
Yes.
You're getting ready. You have answers. You in the shower must be like putting together all of this stuff. Are you going to be disappointed if you don't see him, or if you do see him and he doesn't even try to talk to you? Is that a disappointment?
Well, the second one can't happen. If he saw me, he'll be either, you know, talking with his eyes or something. He won't be able to help himself.
Talking with his eyes.
Okay, you know, these people that just stare.
That counts.
And it's your turn.
You should run bets, and talking with your eyes only counts if at least two of your siblings co-sign that those were legit words.
Right. No, I've made so many plans. I think I take 6 showers a day just to talk to myself about what's going to happen. You know, like, oh, I have another thought. And I run into the bathroom. And I'm not joking about BetterHelp. You guys know about this? 2021, mental health is finally a thing that you can talk about. And how many people are struggling right now with the pandemic and, you know, life? Well, therapy helps. And it's time to stop being ashamed of being a human goddamn being. BetterHelp is customized online therapy. They offer video, phone, and even live chat sessions. Hemda's a huge fan as well.
It's so helpful. I don't know how you're not a fan. I really think, I've said this before, you might think everything's fine, but you're reacting funny. You're not recognizing the movements that you're making, or the decisions that you're making are not panning out, or there's just an agitation, or nothing is wrong, which let's get real. That's
right.
Iconic.
More affordable than in-person therapy. Again, I thought it'd be the opposite. More affordable, and I could do it wherever I want, however I want. Join the millions of people who are seeing what therapy is all about. Okay, the podcast is sponsored by BetterHelp, and Keith and the Girl listeners get 10% off your first month at BetterHelp.com/KATG. That's BetterHelp.com/KATG. Okay. This weekend as well, Xerxes and Hemda are having a production meeting for Silent Trailers. You know Silent Trailers. It's the greatest game show of all time, as mentioned by the New York Times. And you know how now we have categories. So Hemda doesn't know anything about movies, doesn't know anything about celebrities.
I'm called a survivor, okay? Surviving life by not knowing this extra information that you people seem to carry around with you, okay? I am a lighter human being. If I don't know who Tom Cruise is, thank me and go, oh, when I meet you, you're going to go, I don't know you. So when I meet Tom Cruise, he's going to thank me and go, thank you. No one has asked me what my name was in decades. In fact, no one's referencing me anymore, Hemda. So even your reference is old. Thank you. I have won and survived life.
So we have Hemda describe the movie trailers that she sees, right? That's what's funny. And I've seen every movie ever made instead of learning emotion. And so I go up against contestants that are trying to beat me. And I'm on a streak. I got to tell you that. Anyway, during this production meeting, Hemda and Xerxes will go over the categories you know, of these movies. For example, I remember one recently was, okay, this topic is Cheerios. What could it mean? It ended up being movies about serial killers.
Thank you. Very clever. Mm-hmm. That was a fun production meeting.
Blowjobs was about hair salons, if I recall correctly.
You got to have elevated thinking.
Legalize It was movies with sex workers in it.
Legalize It, man.
So Hendon Xerxes are opening up the meeting to you. You can sit in on the meeting, watch, or throw in your two cents, come up with categories. I'm going to try to wear a wig and sneak in, but we'll see. Sign up at keithmcgrill.com/tickets. You'll see everything right there. The category production meeting, as well as the silent trailer show that comes a week later, all available at keithmcgrill.com/tickets. Thank you. Now, let me tell you how excited I am about today's show. I go, today is going to be a great day. I start the day with Magic Spoon. You know about Magic Spoon, Kenta.
Oh, yeah.
Magic Spoon is cereal that's good. Reminds you of that sweet cereal when you were a kid, but now you're an adult and you can't eat all that junk and crap. That's where they come in. 0 grams of sugar for this cereal. 13 to 14 grams of protein. 4 net grams of carbs in each serving. Only 140 servings, only 140 calories a serving. Keto friendly, gluten free, grain free, soy free, low carb, GMO free.
You are blowing our guest's mind. She is the best mime in the universe right now. Her head's exploding. So she's going to put her head together and then we're going to bring her in.
Here's some of the flavors. Ready? Cocoa.
Mm, that's my favorite.
Fruity, frosted. You get what they're doing? You know these cereals, but you don't know it like this. Peanut butter, cinnamon, and now brand new birthday cake. What?
You still get to call yourself an adult.
Yes.
And eat this.
Yeah. I said, today's a special day. I deserve it. And if you're listening from Canada, you can play along as well. Magic Spoon now ships there as well. Okay. So go to magicspoon.com/KATG. Grab the new limited edition birthday cake or a custom bundle of cereal to try it today. And be sure to use promo code KATG at checkout. Save $5 off your order. Okay. The offer is good anywhere in the US or Canada, but only when you use the code at checkout. Magic Spoon is so confident. If you don't like it, boom, get all your money back. 100% happiness guarantee. If you don't like it for any reason, they refund you. No questions asked. Remember, get your next delicious bowl of guilt-free cereal at magicspoon.com/KTG. Use code KTG. Save $5. Okay.
And they didn't say what a sample size is. Try it, quote unquote. Mm-hmm. I'm a two-bowl trier. You know what I mean?
Right. You got to make sure.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Today's guest had a fantastic show that was featured at the New York International Film Festival. It was called All Atheists Are Muslim. A contributor to the New York Times. The podcast that I would listen to went on for about 5 years. Good Muslim, bad Muslim. Zahra Noorbakhsh. Hello.
Hello.
Hello. We're really here to find out how we're related.
Right. This is going to be a short conversation.
It is. What's the nationality? And are both your parents the same nationality?
I mean, whoever really knows. I'm Iranian.
Okay.
My dad is from Isfahan. Went to Tehran. And
my dad's from
there.
Tehran.
Look at this.
And my mom is from Qom, Q-O-M, the religious capital of Iran.
Well, it's good to see her. Zahra June, right? Huh?
Yes. Huh? Oh, so endearing.
Thank you. Thank
now, you. I've heard you talk about being Iranian, Persian, and I think you sort of said something similar that I went through. Correct me if I'm wrong. When I was younger, I was growing up in the 80s. We didn't have in the U.S. the greatest relationship with Iran. And I started being a little uncomfortable saying I'm Iranian. It sort of represented something. So when I found the word Persian, I'm like, oh, Persian cat, Persian rug. These are things that Americans associate with being rich and cultured. And so I'm Persian.
Pier one.
So then I was Persian. Then it was like, the Iraq war. My mother's parents are from Iraq. I'm like, well, I can't say I'm like Iraq and Persian. And now I'm just like, okay, I found a new word. Middle Eastern freaks people out. I'm Mediterranean. but I always feel a little uncomfortable saying
I hear that a lot. I was taught to tell my teachers that Iran is a province of Italy and Asia.
It's so funny that like I'm not even condoning this now. I say it. I'm Iranian. I don't speak Persian, but this is my history. I don't try to cover it up as much, but it was just odd. Like you see the cluelessness sort of in people's mind. And then as the clues come in, you're like, those don't look like good clues coming into your face.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Now I just say that I was born in a Petri dish in a terrorist cell.
Right.
In Arizona. And it's been a journey ever since.
Have you been to Iran?
I have. I've went once when I was 2 and once when I was 14.
Mm. We're gonna count the 14 one.
Yeah. Anything stick with you? Like, do you remember that?
I actually did a piece about it for The Moth because it was so profound. All my life, my mom had always been telling me, you know, why do you care what Tiffany thinks? Why do you care what Stephanie thinks? Yes. In Iran, you have 100 people who love you no matter what.
Right.
Yeah. You heard that too, Hamda?
They wouldn't buy me the stuff like they
that yours. Was
yeah whatever was popular Keds yep. You know, I Keds were like maybe 20-30 bucks, but the one without the blue dot in the bot and the back of it was, and it's like, oh well, what do you care if she was going to throw herself off the building, would you? I'm like, you keep saying that everything I do represents you and you care so much more about how your friends feel about me than how you do. This is crazy.
When I went to Iran, I saw all those 100 people my mom talked about.
Right.
We were in the airport. She was just like crying and all these faces like squished against the pane, taking photos and screaming her name. And my sister and I were like, whoa, are we famous in Iran? What is this?
Right.
Shut up. And I'm your uncle, aunt, cousin. And it was just wild to be, you know, coming out of middle school where everyone just hates themselves and each other and the world. Mm-hmm. To be around that much love. And I was like, I want to live here forever. And then my dad said, by the way, we're staying.
By the way, we're staying?
Yeah, because all the way up until that point, we were wondering, are we going to stay? Are we going to go back? My parents were sort of like stuck here when the revolution hit. They were students with a student visa, couldn't even get jobs. They hadn't planned on living here. They had just come for education. And ever since then, they were like, we might go back. We don't listen to music. Don't do anything American. Just wear black and chill.
Oh, wow. You were in an in-between state. So like, don't Americanize yourself because you're going to have to go back. So you had to sort of hold on to the culture just in case, so you'd still fit in. Well, that's troubling.
And then when he came back, you know, we came back from the trip and my dad sort of came to my room and he goes, we're staying. So watch
in the
VH1.
US.
Yeah. Watch VH1 and catch up.
Huh.
You're
not even
US
MTV.
Kid now.
So when you went at 14, you go to Iraq. How long do you stay there?
Iran.
How long do you stay there?
I think we were there for like a month and a half.
Okay.
Not even very long. Yeah.
Now, when you come back, when you did get back to America, did you miss the other country? Did like
entirely.
As soon as a substitute teacher tries to say your name, are you like, why didn't we stay? Right? Like, you know, it's about Zahra. And you're like, okay, I'm here. I'm here. Don't embarrass me. I'm here. Teachers act like they can't look at your name and read it. They act like they have to glance at it real quick and guess.
What the hell is with that, man? It's all phonetically spelled for you. My people write in squiggles.
Right.
It's for you.
There's extra K's to be clear.
I mean, they also, it's not my fault. Y'all came up with a KH to represent huh.
Right.
I mean, you could have put a sigma in there and it would probably have the same effect.
Are you thinking about the visiting as an adult?
I cannot go back.
Because?
A couple reasons. I was featured in the book, the anthology Love Inshallah, The Secret Love Lives of American Muslim Women. Not so secret anymore.
Right.
And the New York Times, what an honor. First line says Zahra Noorbakhsh writes about sex. And when you go to the airport in Iran and you're, you know, going through the checkpoints and things, one of the things that they sometimes do is Google you.
Mm-hmm.
And that, you know, I'd be banking on them not checking. And that's one scary. Of the things, yeah, one of the things I learned too late was that a lot of folks who need to travel safely in the Middle East do not use their last name for performing and being and their thought leadership in the world. They use their maiden name or a pen name, not the name that's also on their passport. Would have been good to know that.
Right.
And after I wrote about coming out as bisexual, that pretty much meant I'm not going to get to see my grandma in her home country anymore.
You, when there was the Pulse nightclub shooting, am I correct that that's what said, hey, even if I'm in a straight relationship for years, add me to the list of people this could be affecting.
Yes.
And that will get you killed in the home country.
I don't know.
Right.
Maybe not.
Right.
Maybe not. But yeah, not an appealing airport visit to find out. Right.
Wow. So I for sure can't go. I have over 3,000 episodes that say I right. can't go. Ooh. Okay.
Are they Googleable?
Oh, yeah. Oh.
Yeah, I mean, you guys have very specific names. It's not, what if we have the wrong person? Now, you have Kenda, you have Zahra.
My first name is a couple of first pages in Google. You don't even have to put my last name.
It autofills. Like, you start with Kem because we know where you're going with this. Here she is.
Can we both change our name then to Mas Jabrani and just do a workaround?
I was very close. My brothers both changed their names and I was very close to changing my name. I just, I couldn't do it, but it was going to be Nicole. Mm. And I don't think that goes. And then I'd end up having to be like, you know what, Nicole, please. I have to go back to my roots. This is terrible.
The stigma on that C. Just,
I like that idea.
Yeah.
Hey, what am I remembering that you wrote for? You were paid to study bro culture in comedy. Am I saying this properly? Paid for a year. What do you learn other than dudes?
Yeah, I studied the stand-up comedy development pipeline for 1 year with a fellowship from an organization called the Pop Culture Collaborative. Mm-hmm. And what I found is that basically the depletion of folks who are Black or Indigenous or people of color in stand-up comedy, our sort of depletion of our talent pool begins much sooner at all the access points in the early development phases. So like for a white guy, being at a bar is a safe space. It's a place of comfort. It's a place where, you know, they can kind of unwind, be them sometimes their terrible self.
Right.
And, you know, everybody's kind of drunk and having fun. And it's a place where they get to sort of assert themselves a little bit more where, you know, even just as women, that's not a place that I ever have seen as a safe place. It's always been a place to go with a friend, keep an eye on your drink.
What were you doing there? Why were you there?
Yeah. And also like the vibes you're giving off that guys kind of respond to. And I remember kind of my early comedy days, even of just like having to constantly navigate guys coming up to me to say they're going to book me for a show, but it turns out that they just want to hook up. And when I'm not interested, neither are they, right. You know, and it's not a real office. There's no HR, you know, it's all sort of cultural assumptions. And we call that, you know, equal opportunity endeavor, but it's not really. And it kind of also skews your material. So that one of the things that we're sort of graded on as comics is our ability to read the room, you know, and I'm getting up on stage and I can feel the room wondering, who's this ethnically ambiguous chick? How's she going to take the stage? Is she going to, you know, command authority? Do I want to give her that? All these questions before I even open my mouth. But when a white guy gets up on stage and holds a mic, a position of power with a white guy is something where used to seeing. It's not unusual to us. And so we're just curious what he's going to do with that microphone. And we're already on for the ride.
Right. Is it very exhausting? Like, I mean, that it sounds like a dumb question as I'm saying it, but you know what they're thinking. I have to go
ask. Before you ask if it's very exhausting, I just want to remind you, imagine how many naps you take. Now imagine how many naps we have to take. Now, what was your question?
do you feel like, hey, I gotta teach these guys some lesson within 2 minutes. I gotta talk about my gender. I have to talk about my race before they can relax and be comfortable with a joke. Does it work like that?
Yeah, it does. I mean, I like a friend of mine, when I was working on the report, I interviewed a bunch of my comedy friends, and one of them had mentioned that she got up on stage and said, and actually it was Zahra Ali, another amazing comic you should check out. She said that one time she just got up on stage and said, "It's my birthday." And no one laughed or cheered after she said, "Hey, I'm Zahra Ali, Pakistani American." And then they all went, and they were with her.
I didn't know if she could have a birthday or not. I didn't know if she was allowed to say that. So I was confused.
Exactly. What? Right.
And I have to admit that I found out along the way, as people are talking about this more and more, that I do it as well, even as a woman. I see a woman doing something, I'm like, wow, good for her. How are you doing that? Sort of like, you know, unintentionally, subconsciously, if she does something where normally maybe I'm used to it from my childhood, like this is a male role, this is somebody even from my ethnic background, I'm like, I think of their parents. Do they know that they're saying this stuff? Like all this kind of stuff is running through my head. And at the end I go, she's funny. And I'm like, fuck, did I not expect her to be funny? Fuck. Mm. You know, it's still like a little bit in me where at least now I'm more conscious of it. So I think that's like a good step to letting it go.
And after when you do this research, do you then get backlash from dudes? Like, well, it's not all dudes, honey. Did you get crap for that?
I think because of when it came out,
They didn't read it, but we know the headline. It was controversial.
My memory.
I think it was called "Women Are People," and I'm like, "What's she trying to?" You
know. I don't need to read those.
Right.
My memory of the before times is entirely shot, and 2019 is very much a blur.
Sure.
I believe during that time in 2019, we were also, you know, hearing all the stuff about Louis C.K. You know, Weinstein, things were coming to a head. And I think when that happened, when the stuff with Louis C.K. and with the Today Show dude, who I'm so glad I forgot his
Matt
name.
Matt Lauer, Cosby.
Don't do that to me. Don't
Sorry.
Do that to me.
I was just naming dudes.
Oh, my God. I think that, you know, folks started to listen real differently across the board.
Okay.
And I felt guys listening real differently. But what are they really saying? Tell us, Keith.
Yeah, Keith.
What's the man meeting? Come on.
Yeah, they're not going to. We know.
What's the man newsletter say? The muse letter.
We don't show up to our meetings too much. That's our privilege. We don't have to have groups. You guys figure it out.
You just hang out long enough to give each other COVID and then break.
Right. Yes, exactly. No, of course, you know, a comedy club so relatable to a bar. And what's the dudes taught to get the prize, that they're the underdog almost, and they have to get you. And then you're taught, you're taught how to fight it or get away.
Yeah. I mean, so many of the things that I learned through the report were like, of course, that makes sense. You know, like folks who are, you know, Asian and East Asian and who don't want to be picked on, they just stop going. Because what would happen is they would show up to the club and they get seated right in the front. You're Indian, you're Asian, you're East Asian. Let's, you know, and the comedian does their, you know, insult comedy testing on them. And so folks, a lot of people of color just stop going to comedy clubs. And so then it sort of creates this false understanding of truth on the part of comics who spend, you know, 4 to 6 years going to bars and clubs thinking that they're getting a diverse crowd of folks, and that whoever's not there just doesn't like comedy. It turns out they just don't like racism.
Right. Mm. Yeah. Yeah. How are you doing now with, how were you doing during the pandemic? And are there nerves now that it's supposedly ending?
And by the way, has the pandemic been called off? Because I feel weird being like, now that the pandemic, I don't know how to finish that sentence. Am I still in a pandemic? I still am scared. I had to drop something off at Keith's place. It was weird the other day. And
I'm visiting my family. You know.
And I'm like, this is so rude. I still don't want to stand anywhere near you. And we're wearing masks.
Every day feels like Thursday to me.
For the record, I threw it at him. But yes, that's that's a good way to put it.
I hardly go out. I know I was saying that I went on Memorial Day. I went with, you know, my my girlfriend and her stepkids. But
your stepkids, they're her kids.
Oh, that's why she cares so much. These kids. First of all, let me just tell everybody, I haven't driven a car in years and I'm still alive.
And he was terrible at it when he was driving. I'll admit it. I'm not being mean.
I was
happy you're alive.
Thank you. Yeah, I was a little nervous. I was borrowing a friend's car. I drove it from Brooklyn to my place in Queens. And then that night, then the next morning, I get in the car and all of a sudden there's this high pitched whine that won't go away and the brakes aren't properly working.
Now, have I watched too many movies where I'm hearing a high pitched whine and the brakes aren't working properly? I want to get out of the car and start running and just like deal with it from far away so that if it is about to explode, I always think cars are about to explode when they're not being run right. Right. When things happening, like, oh, now the car explodes.
And it makes me feel, is our buddy Matt Bray's car. And I got to be like, the brakes aren't working. I don't know what's going on. You know your car. Do you mind coming over? And it's like he has to, you know, I get him an Uber. He comes over to Queens and I'm like, here's your car back. I felt terrible, but it would have been, you know, we went to Lake George hours away. It would have been completely unsafe. And I felt bad. He understood. Then I go to rent a car, which, you know, might as well do that last minute Memorial Day. That's only $6,000. So, but I'm not. Now, these new cars, first of all, anybody can drive nowadays. When you have that map on the dashboard that talks to you, and you can, I don't know, I sound weird, like everybody knows this by now, but you know, you look at your dashboard, you see what's behind you, and there's lines to guide you. And I probably didn't even take a full advantage of everything that it offers. Anyone can parallel park. Anybody can drive anywhere. And I mean, the tight turns, cars are amazing.
I wish this was our car commercial ad. It just, that's what they should do with us for all ads. They're like, why don't you try our thing? And we're like, have you guys heard of this? It's technology.
Right. Well, it's weird when it's always weird to me when they give you a car to rent and they just leave, like give you the keys and they turn around. Like you didn't even need to see me round the corner.
That's like, I think you go to babysit and they're like, you've met kids before. Here are mine. It's like, no, this is the numbers that you need to dial when something happens. This one's allergic to this thing. Like a couple of a couple of details, you know.
Take so I don't car.
So now, because that's the day we're leaving, now I'm running late. I stop by my house and then I pull out into, I have like a little parking lot that goes right into the street. I back up into the street. I'm not sure what I did. All of a sudden the car stops. I can't move it. Bus comes by. I'm like, okay, you know what hazards mean? I don't know what to tell you. You know what I did?
I called Matt and got him an Uber to come over to see.
Yeah. Well, actually, my landlord was around. I just happened to see him. And I go, are you still in the neighborhood? Can you see if I'm missing something? And then he's fidgeting with things. He's like, oh, okay, it's working now. I'm like, all right, well, let's hope that doesn't happen on a highway.
Change?
I'm not really sure. I think somehow, I don't know how I would have done this. I backed up. And then turn the car off, maybe. And then you have to brake and push the button. You know, it's push button now instead of turning a key.
What kind of car?
The The car was probably never on. You rolled back.
Oh, you think
you're
so?
Yeah. To be alive.
You hit the reverse and your driveway is a little bit on a slant.
Yeah.
So you might have thought that you were, but if you didn't know that you had to press the brake and turn it on at the same time, you never turned it on. So
maybe
when you
you're right.
When you put it in drive, you couldn't drive. No, this is how, but now this is expected. Like, don't think of logical things of what happened with the car. You have to think at the basic level, he didn't turn it on. And I love it. And I love why, I'm going to guess why you called your landlord. Yes, he was right there. But you consider him a manly man who's just going to know. And Keith doesn't consider himself a manly man for this, like for in this department. He's
in the car department.
Right.
In the putting things together.
When Matt goes, oh, it's my vacuum pump brake. And I'm like, yeah, the VPB. Sure. Anyway.
Yeah. So he's happy to be like, Hamda, you're a manly man in this department.
Right.
Like, why don't you?
Yeah.
And are you good with cars?
I mean, I speak car enough for Keith, so I might seem like a little bit more, but no, not at all. But I blew a piston out of my car one time because I didn't take care of it. I don't even know what that means. I was told.
Right.
Are you good with cars?
Me?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm really good at critiquing cars. I'm a very good critiquer of like insufficient, don't know what this means. This doesn't speak to me. And I would like someone to drive this instead of me.
Yes.
Right.
Yeah.
I was so amazed by new cars now. It reminded me when I went to buy a TV and I go, you know what? I think I'm going to go flat screen. Idiot. Everything's flat screen. You don't have a choice. So I'm not like, oh, that was an easy decision. Now I debate if I want 3D. What? So I mean, the cars are so cool. So when other people, I mean, I'm driving a family, so everybody wants their music to play. So whoever's sitting in the front starts turning the knob to the to the radio. I just lower it on my on the steering wheel, and they keep trying to raise it. I keep lowering it. They're not sure, but they know they did the muscle memory move, and everybody's happy.
Okay, can we talk about cars and muscle memory? I have a lot of opinions about this, actually.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. What the fuck? Because when I'm driving my computerized car now, it can only do one thing at a time. I can, you know how you used to be able to like, I sound so old now. Okay. You know, you used to be able to drive the car and also change the AC, go in reverse, flip a guy off and make a friend in the other window. But now.
Right. They're like, it's not an omelet, it's a car. They want you to focus on each individual thing.
I like go in reverse and it's like, don't touch the AC, one thing at a time.
Yeah, you're right. I noticed that. Reverse takes away everything.
I hate it. Yeah, I'm hot.
Right. I get nervous when I go in reverse.
I just want to change it. It's hot.
But yeah, I made him listen to my music on the way to our place. It's my way for the highway. You know what I mean?
Okay. So also, I'm a very good parallel parker. I was taught how to park by a man who drove through Tehran. And I also learned how to park in Berkeley, California. Like I can squeeze any vehicle into any snug spot, but cars now, because they have the front and rear view cameras and because they're always trying to upsell you on getting the front camera, they don't care what you can see out of the rear view inside.
You're right. You're right. If I look, you can't. Yeah, it's real skinny. The window was so skinny, almost like a sports car where I'm like, I can't see behind me. This is dangerous. And then, of course, you see there's 17 TVs in the car and you're like, oh, actually, I do see everything. It's like a fucking tank. But all right.
I was also very proud of my parallel parking. I learned in New York City. And so I have absolutely taken pictures of my parking.
Right. Like food.
Yeah, exactly. I'm just like, look at this. Somebody has to see this. And I'd post it and say, it took me one time, one reverse, no back and forth. But now who gives a shit? Nobody even knows what we're talking about. We're talking about rotary phones for all people knows. Like, this is ridiculous.
Yeah. You know, you ask somebody now, are you able to parallel park? It's like, are you able to walk?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, yeah, I get in the car.
And who's parallel parking? You just go, I'm here. And the car starts going.
There are cars that parallel for you with the cameras.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. My girlfriend, by the way, said I look sexy when I'm driving. That's a trick, right? Just so I keep driving, right? And I'm like, you're a bombshell when you clean my stove. Like, I don't really look sexy when I'm driving, which is a 12-hour goddamn back and forth journey.
No, I think she's God, being genuine. You look hot.
I wonder.
Yeah, my husband's the hottest when he's taking out the trash and See? Doing the dishes.
Right.
It's just hot. I'm just good looking.
Yeah, in all fairness, she doesn't have a license, so she needs Keith to look hot.
Oh, crap. Right. I'm literally trapped here, so it's pretty hot how mobile you are.
These kids, by the way. Oh,
these kids.
They don't know how. I'll tell you. I'll sound old. They don't know how they have it made. We go to eat somewhere.
Do they have it made? I don't know.
Were you able as a kid to go, hey, Ma, can I get the scallops? And then when you get the $35 scallops and you eat one, did you ever have the lips to go, hey, I don't really like them. Can I have some of your steak? What?
I'm sorry. Wait, I have to reevaluate my entire life on the unit economy of scallops. I have not done that. And I love scallops. I order the spicy scallop hand roll, even if it's not on the menu, even if it's at Denny's. I love scallops.
Yeah.
This changes everything.
He gets scallops. He got scallops for lunch, right? He goes, I don't really care for them. Then at dinner at another fancy place, he goes, can I get the scallops? Oh, I don't care for the. You don't like scallops. Your mom doesn't like broccoli, Rob. You don't like scallops. I go to bring the food home, but that's 7 hours in the car. And I'm like, is it still safe to eat? Then I Google, is it safe to eat food? They go, no, you throw out everything after 2 hours. Well, how can fish be the same as a frozen dinner? It can't all be 2 hours, you dorks. But I didn't know the right thing. So I threw them out, and wasting money and food disgusts me.
Five scallops. Yeah, that's a five scallop experience.
Yeah.
Okay,
when did the daughter get this one, Zahra? The daughter, like, cuts me off a piece of her steak, little piece for me to try. It falls off the fork on the table, you know, with a cloth.
Uh-huh.
And so she goes to cut me another steak. And then I just reach over and I put my fork on that food. And she's like, oh, you're going to eat that? Yes, millionaire. It's a table. Yes, I'm going to eat it, Richie Rich. The fuck?
Imagine this is why we don't care about women at comedy clubs. You suck. You just suck. I have a sister. I've already said too much, and I'm going to get a text message, who does the whole, what do you want to eat? I want to go wherever you want to go. Mm-hmm. I'm not hungry for that. Right. How about, no, I don't want that. No. Yeah. How about Cheesecake Factory? Just like literally right. Every time she's like, let's go out and have dinner. I want to eat what you eat. Like,
and you try to be specific sometimes to people. So I'll talk to my girlfriend. I'm like, I know you're specific. So let's just end it and you be specific. So the other day she goes, well, what do you want? And I'm like, well, it's really you, so I don't care. And she goes, wow, why don't you be specific? I go, all right, hamburgers. Not in the mood for that. What the fuck are you?
I know I do that. See, the thing is I don't want to decide food every single time. So Xerxes will go, what do you want to eat? And I go, here's what I want for lunch. I want to not have to make a decision. That's what I want for lunch. But then he'll be like hamburgers. And I'm like, I'm not always a hamburger person. He's like, just pick something wet and eat it.
Wet and eat it. Whoa, that was my date once. Damn.
He noticed that I like wet food. I like sauces and things.
Do either of you do this when you spend money on something silly? You find yourself spending more money because if I can afford the silly thing, let me give myself something more practical. If I just paid $1,000 for a car for a weekend, you know what? Fuck it. I'm debating about a new printer. This one's not Wi-Fi. I'm buying it. Like, I spend more money if I half waste money.
I don't buy silly things. How about you, Hamda? I buy, you know, I pay for rent. I pay for scallops. Mm-hmm. And I pay for my internet. And, you know, I try not to get silly. Like, okay, sure, I own a puppy and another dog. And okay, maybe I have more glitter than is necessary because I don't have children. And sure, I've got stationery for bullet journals that I've never made in 3 years mm-hmm. and Etsy accounts. But I mean, you know, I'm still going to return that thing.
Right. I struggle with that, actually. So if I don't like to order in a lot. I mean, I like to, but I do think it's a waste of money. It's not always good food. It's like a lot of times I think we make the food better here, but you just kind of want the food to show up. So my issue is I look at the restaurant and I'm like, what I really want is bruschetta, right? But bruschetta is chopped up tomatoes with a little bit of pesto and garlic and put on bread. And I'm like, why do I need to be charged? And now I'm fighting with what tomatoes on bread is. I can't make myself tomatoes on bread. Now I'm going to spend $10 with tomatoes on bread. And I'm like, oh, but I really like the flavors that they put together. And I know I'm not going to make. And now I'm arguing. And so I'm like, why don't I just get the pizza? That's just like tomato on bread, but I'll have more of it. And the math is just so annoying. So on days where I could be like, look, you're ordering, spend the extra $2, get the exact right thing that you want. Or, you know, get an extra time once a month is not going to be the same. Does that make sense? Like you're not really saving that much money, not getting exactly what you want.
Oh, I dig this.
Can you imagine though? I don't think I care for these scallops. Do you know that when I was a kid and we would get a hamburger, a 35 cent hamburger at McDonald's. We each got our own and a large fries for all of us to share. A family of seven. I was sick that day for whatever reason. I got home. I threw up the burger, but I felt like I had to hide it so it didn't look like I was wasting 35 cents. Now, I see the problem with that, but a little in between.
You know what I realized recently, actually? So when I was a kid, we didn't eat out a lot. My mother always said, we have food at home. We have food at home.
Right.
But when
we
would go, and you know what? You grow up and you're like, yeah, she was kind of right. And she cooks really good. But when we would go out to a restaurant, it would be a kosher place, most likely Chinese food. And my father would order for all of us, not our individual plate, but he'll be like, we want like this dish, this is this dish. It all gets put in the middle and you just kind of take what you want. You could throw it out like, you know, dad, can we make sure to include one of these dishes? But he's doing it. So I didn't eat much going out. And I remember I started dating someone and he's like, oh, it's in between shit. Let's go to this diner. And I'm like, there's food at home. There's food at home. That's what I'm thinking in the back of my head. And so I looked for the cheapest thing on the menu. Ended up, I ordered home fries. And he's like, what is this? And I'm like, oh, I guess I'm not that hungry. I'm like, what is wrong with me? This is the weirdest thing you can do with someone. Like, I'll just have home fries because that's totally a meal. I mean, and I didn't know to explain and to, I didn't even know where it was coming from that I was ordering home fries. So he just sat there thinking like, that's what I want from a diner.
And now it's a birthday gift, an anniversary gift, home fries. I remember
home exactly.
fries.
There it is.
I don't even like home fries. What do you mean you don't like home fries?
My niece said, like eggs or anything.
What? My niece said yesterday when I went to go get her, I was going to order her an ice cream cake for her birthday. My sister and I were doing this whole like birthday week thing. And she goes, oh, you know what? I had dessert today, so I'm okay.
Oh,
she's okay. 10.
Wow.
She's 10. Is that what you said?
Yeah.
Yeah. Get that checked out.
Oh, no. Her parents should write a book. I didn't know how to say shit like that. How do you get your kid to go, no, thanks. I'm full up and satisfied. Oh,
I've had enough dessert. Thank you.
You know, the daughter told on me. So she's like 16 or about to be 16. She's not. Listen to this. So we're in the car. It's just me and her. We're going to the store. Okay. And you know, kids, like if something excites you, you're a dork, right? Yeah. You have to walk around mopey and not give a fuck for anything.
Right.
Well, she's that type of person. And we got back from the ride and and this gets back to me. She goes, wow, Keith's real quiet. He wasn't talking to me in the car at all. I'm like, oh, yeah, chatterbox. I was a top. First of all, I said, how are you? How do you like this vacation? How does it compare to other vacations? They were half word answers. Then I'm done talking. Sure.
Wait, is she giving you a two scallop rating? She's just basically like, my Uber driver was not entertaining at all.
Yeah. Yeah. Damn. I let you play your music from your phone. I mean, I kept lowering it, but you didn't know that.
So, I was not engaged. I was not spoken to.
Right. And we did. Why don't you tell your mom what we were talking about? Well, we tell your mom how you said, hey, Keith, you still smoke, meaning weed. And I go, I can't give you weed. And you go, no, I have my own. And I said, great. Now, that's riveting conversation you might have told your mom about. And then I go, which reminds me, how the fuck did you get caught with weed in your backpack in school? She goes, hey, it smelled and they smelled it. What do you mean we didn't have riveting conversation? She goes, you know what? Before we get in the car, you know what? Can you just give me 2 or 3 minutes? I know that meant she's not, you know, back at where we're staying and she's going to smoke. I go, no. Then we pass a cop car. And I go, that cop would have found you, by the way. And she goes, not if I was behind the cop. I don't know what the fuck that meant.
What?
But yes, there was plenty of riveting conversation.
Behind?
Who the fuck knows?
Yeah, that's pretty riveting.
He didn't talk much. I corrected your behavior.
Oh, wait, what if that was her trying to cover for your drug talk, though? And then you blew the cover.
He didn't say anything.
Yeah. And then you're like, we talked about drugs. We talked about sex workers. We talked about
just generally cocaine. Legalize it.
It's funny because I'll be like,
dreams you have.
I don't know. Like, where do I jump in as a stepdad? And so I'm like, you know, make sure you're going to therapy and you're telling them things that are bothering you. And she's like, oh, I do. I go. And I'm just like, I know yesterday you didn't show up. So I'm like, okay, well, that's the end of that conversation. What am I going to do? Okay, liar. Now, can we really discuss it? No. So yes, liar. Half the car trip was quiet. Of course. Like, I do go. You don't go.
Did you end up narking on her?
I told everything. You don't turn on me. What could that have went to? The mom's pleased with me? No, she could only be upset with me. She's not, but if it went one way or the other, the mom wouldn't be pleased I didn't converse enough. So why are you trying to ruin us? Why do you fucking ray of sunshine?
Imagine this is your stepdad.
A flat screen TV now, so...
Oh my god.
We'll see if I get a Father's Day card.
Which
I won't, but that's good because that happens before her birthday, the daughter's birthday. So since I know that's not going to be addressed, I don't think I have to address the birthday, right?
You should get her a Father's Day card to give to you.
Right. And then act surprised. That's something my dad would have done. Yeah.
When you get together with them, I thought, as I said, when we get together with them, the rest would come back, and it hasn't come back.
Then let me tell you about this then. That's all right. Go ahead. You're ready now. God forbid 2 seconds went by and it wouldn't come to you.
Okay. You know how when Kyle says something, you kind of can go, all right, that's going in the show. You fucked up.
And yeah, I tell on her, when she pushes it.
Do you do that with the kids, or is that weird?
I don't want them to know what I necessarily say on this show. So no, I don't threaten them with that.
Okay.
But, you know.
Just seeing where you're at.
No, but I do know if they don't do something nice, like give me story worth, there's going to be a problem. I know that. Story worth is an online service that helps your dad, your grandfather, father-in-law, whatever father figure you have in your life, share stories through thought-provoking questions about their memories and personal thoughts. So they'll get emails that say, hey, here's a question. What was the proudest moment of your life? And they just, they're not thinking. They fill it out. Oh, you're getting to know me.
It's a perfect thing. You know how, so Keith, when he was dating, he was actually reading people's profiles and like maybe bringing a small gift based on something that they said. One example was like, they really like Whoppers in a movie theater. He was meeting that woman in the movie theater. He came with Whoppers. How adorable. This is the version. You can send a Keith Malley a story worth if he's your stepdad. Mm-hmm. Now he's letting you know about himself. And you could be complete butter going like, because we know Keith, he was like this in high school. And how endearing is that?
And the next thing you know, they make a book and it's a nice presentation of all these memories. And you go, hey, this was your life. Gotcha. Tricked you. Give your dad the most meaningful gift this Father's Day with StoryWorth. Get started right away with no shipping required by going to StoryWorth.com/KTG. You got $10 off your first purchase. That's StoryWorth.com/KATG. Get your $10 off.
Get it, StoryWorth, because it's a story worth sharing.
Yes, yes. All right, let's do a little lightning round here of top news stories. First of all, if there's any confusion, you may not eat at Chick-fil-A. I wasn't sure what the rules were now. They said they were behaving.
They're never behaving.
You're allowed to eat a nice chicken sandwich, and they're never behaving. They're still giving money to anti-gay companies.
I don't know why anyone was thinking that different things would happen.
I heard like the owner died, and I'm like, okay, if he's dead, that's good, you know. So maybe it's okay now. And they say, hey, we're making sure that we're not giving money to any whatever. They still were. I didn't realize that. Not nice. Not nice. And now, but this is funny. Now Burger King is being clear that they're not anti-gay. By saying during Pride Month, your chicken sandwich craving can do good. Every time you buy a sandwich, 40 cents goes to human rights company. Human Rights Campaign is America's largest LGBTQ civil rights organization. That's what it's called, Human Rights Campaign. And they're like, not only will we do that, we'll even do it on Sundays. A little wink at Chick-fil-A closing on Sundays for religious reasons.
Do you want to know how I already know that they're giving a small portion to LGBTQ community?
How's that?
Because that's how Xerxes was trying to sell me on buying on getting Burger King yesterday.
Oh yeah. Like, didn't we just have that yesterday? Oh, are they getting too much money?
Man, I can't do fast food anymore.
I hear you.
You never could. I don't know how to break that to you. Right. None of us could. Is there a specific reason? Is it gluten?
Oh, I could take it. I had to get my gallbladder removed.
Oh, do you need that for fast food?
Yeah, because it processes fats. And I could still eat it, but then I'd shit my pants.
Well, you don't want to do that.
I mean, unless you're ready.
I like that both Humda and I were like, I mean.
if nobody's around and I light some candles, I'll eat it right on the throne. I'm the king. Burger Queen. the host of The Bachelor, Chris Harrison, he got in trouble, if you remember, not too long ago. He was defending Rachel Kirkconnell, who was on that show. She was caught going to an antebellum party in 2018. And he said, we all need to have a little grace, a little understanding, a little compassion. I'm sick of the woke police. Never, you know where someone stands when they use the term woke police. I've seen some stuff online. Again, this judge, jury, executioner thing where people are just tearing this girl's life apart until I actually hear the woman have a chance to speak. Who am I to say any of this is wrong? I saw a picture of her at a sorority party 5 years ago. That's it. Then people said that antebellum parties, especially so recently in her case, is so bad. He said, oh, OK, I didn't know the think. I get paid $5 million a fucking year. But OK, then he says, OK, I'm an imperfect man. I made a mistake and I own that. I believe that mistake doesn't reflect who I am or what I stand for. I am committed to the progress, not just for myself, also for the franchise. And then the company decided, you know what, actually, we had to put you on break. And that's when we realized, what do you do? And now you're fired. Now, Chris Harrison is saying, I want my severance package to be $25 million. And if it's not, I'm going to share secrets of the show that I've learned. I guess producers supposedly have been inappropriate. This is what he's hinting at. There are fights that he thinks would be embarrassing. So that's what he's doing right now. A little blackmail, it seems.
What? Why don't you just say when producers are being inappropriate, you fucking dumb douche?
Right.
Also, so is he actually fired?
He's done. I don't know what the real severance package is. Supposedly, he's demanding $25 million. We are thankful for his many contributions over the past 20 years, says ABC, and we wish him the best on his new journey. This guy, what a great journalist. You know, he would get drunk strangers to fuck in front of their parents. And if we can find somebody to fill that position, I'd be surprised. But we're going to try our best.
All of these little like blasts of we're feeling this way and we wish him the best, or like, you know, I had made a mistake and I learned from my lessons. You know, you can get a PR degree, right? And if I was one of the teachers for your major like that, I would make you all semester write statements that mean absolutely nothing and sound like you're being gracious. It is unbelievable the language that is being used. It seems like life is a certain way that I didn't know it was like. And now that we've had the conversation, which I'm so grateful for, I have learned many lessons and plan to use the lessons that I learned to move forward in my life better with my family. By the way, I have a family. You should look at them. They're still with me because I basically own them. They, can't or don't want to live independently of me because I am the breadwinner, and for some reason they keep hanging around. Anyway, lessons learned, and there's no reason to do anything past this because I'm a good boy now.
An ABC source says he knows a lot about inappropriate behavior on set, fights between contestants, misbehavior, including use of illegal substances while overseas, and complaints from producers that were allegedly brushed under the carpet by ABC execs.
But you're using
Yeah.
But you're using criminal activity that you should be reporting as
yes.
It, so you're just a piece of shit.
Yes. so he's done, and they're gonna have guest hosts. A big name that was thrown out was David Spade will be there in a minute, giving out roses. That I could see that being fun because this Chris Harris, he's a fucking bore, this Chris.
David Spade, this sarcastic face.
Yeah.
Really?
Yeah.
Five scallops.
Right. So that should be fun. You know, Anthony Weiner or Carlos Danger. He ran for
that
a governor.
That last name, man. Mm-hmm. That last name. People
Weiner,
are like,
stop.
Your last name, Weiner.
He didn't have a choice. It's like I was made to be a fucking. Oh,
we all have a choice. Change it to Stone. Change your whole last name to Sharon Stone, Anthony Sharon Stone.
so he gets caught, you know, texting people online, showing his dick and all this during a documentary that's trying to rehabilitate him. The documentary is called Weiner. He's caught in the documentary. More underage girls. Oh, boy.
Oh, my God.
See, if he was strategic, that meant that he's like, look. It really is a disease that I can't control. I knew the cameras were here. It's like I'm in a blackout.
Yeah.
I would graduate top of my class with this bullshit PR shit.
Do you remember the first time he was caught? They were showing a picture.
The first time he tweeted
accidentally. He was trying to send it to somebody and made it public. Maybe he was trying to DM. I don't know. It was him in a chair and you saw his dick through his shorts. And so they're like, hey, why are you here talking about government stuff? Is this picture you? And he's like, I think I was hacked. Now you fucked up because now you involved the FBI. And they go, okay, but is the picture of you? He's like, yeah, I don't know. Like, if you could prove it is, I didn't say no. Like, you don't know. Is that your underwear and your kitchen floor? You don't know.
Well,
it's hard to say. But then we should get back to government stuff and take you seriously.
Oh, Keith, you know how sometimes you don't know what gaslighting is because you're just like, oh, it's lying. That's right. Gaslighting. We're looking at the picture going like, hey, we all know. But like you say anyway. And they're like, I'm so confused. I love all these confused adults. This is very confusing.
I get my underwear at the flea markets and stuff. Nothing matches. I don't know. Have you ever had plaid underwear, Keith? Probably. I don't know.
What'd you say, Zahra?
That cognitive dissonance.
Mm-hmm. Well, anyway, I'm bringing him up because now he is saying that he's probably going to be selling non-fungible tokens, NFTs you've been hearing about, of various lowlights from his sexting addiction. So whatever an NFT is, you'll be able to buy a picture of him that he sent to an underage girl.
Wow.
The picture is not necessarily illegal. It's just a picture of his dick. It's that he sent it. So I guess he can send that picture. Let's see.
Here's the thing with this NFT. You are buying a digital version of it, but that doesn't mean you have the rights to it. So it's like you're buying nothing, but they're going for millions of dollars. How much is his dick going for?
It doesn't say that, but it is going to that tweet where he said the one that he did tweet and said, I don't know if that's me. That's going to be available. A copy of the search warrant for the laptop seized by the FBI. Like, what? No shame. It's probably your fault. And I'm not exaggerating that Hillary Clinton wasn't president of the United States. But now let's sell a warrant as an NFT. Okay.
Oh, my God.
I still blame Putin.
Sure. It didn't help. Yeah. Let's see. The
richest man in the world.
The warrant that sent him to prison with because he was sending to an underage girl, an email in which John Stewart apologized for making jokes at his expense. He's going to sell. Can you imagine for whatever reason, John Stewart goes, and maybe I was too tough on him with my platform, apologizes, then goes, now I'm going to sell this email letter. It's like, well, no, I don't apologize.
Your last name is Weiner,
right?
And you can't stop showing your Weiner. You don't get any apologies.
It's like rain.
The lawyer F. Lee Bailey, whose clients included O.J. Simpson, died. So he's in hell. Do you think when you're burning in hell, do you try to like outsmart Satan? Like when you have a mind like F. Lee Bailey's, where you're like, well, I think everyone deserves a fair. Right. And the devil's like, no, I don't need an advocate down here. That's an earth thing.
Right.
You're burning.
My approach is fungible.
What is that?
I don't know what fungible means, but I really want to say it.
Okay.
Satan, I find this fungible.
Ghislaine Maxwell has applied for the fifth time to receive bail, and she was denied. And I think this is like looking up your credit score too many times. I don't think it looks good.
Okay, right. By the way, I just learned that they don't have credit scores in any other country but this one.
Wow.
Oh.
Yeah. What the?
Hello.
What?
Wow.
Yeah.
It's like money really talks over here or something, you know? But
unless...
yeah, if you're a judge, and you're making the decision, you just look, how many times were you denied? 32? Probably a reason. This is number 33. Like number you can't you quit asking so fast for bail. You're not getting it right now. You look like a real asshole. You know, and I'm glad she does. I want the people to remind. I don't want to be forgetting about her. Like Cosby was denied parole because he won't go to sex classes or you know those rape classes where they teach you not to rape. He wouldn't go to those so that he looked innocent. It's like, well, now you don't get parole and you'll be serving the full 10 years. Good. Let these fucking egotists try all this dumb shit. I love
Weinstein's out, right? Weinstein's out and like hanging.
Yeah. Yeah, so we'll see. We'll see what goes on there, but hopefully he starts complaining too. I love when these people are complaining. Oh, it's fantastic. The court rejected her bid for district court hearing about the conditions under. Yeah, so she also not only does she want bail, she's saying, okay, if I don't get bail, I still want to be somewhere with better conditions. You're punishing me because Jeffrey Epstein killed himself, and I promised not to kill him. And they're like, you're staying here. It's not looking good. Derek Chauvin's. The guy that killed George Floyd, Derek Chauvin, his lawyer said, I think my client should get time served. That he's in jail right now should be his full punishment. Like, this has to be Derek Chauvin's idea, right? Not the lawyer's. Because I think the lawyer would be like, it really makes you look bad, you know? Let's give you 3 months or something.
The man killed an innocent man on camera. He does not care how he looks.
I suppose you're right.
Right.
He didn't get his classes yet. Can you imagine these classes? Ugh.
Here's nauseous every time.
Here's what did you learn what you did wrong? Yeah, I shouldn't have killed a man. Okay. I think you graduated the class. Yeah.
That's just one. We don't even know about his other victims.
Yeah.
That hasn't even come up because of how much protection he gets in media.
Now, Cosby, tell me, why shouldn't you drug women and rape them? What have you learned? go to the front of the
class. Also, Bill Cosby's in jail, right? And Derek Chauvin's like, I don't know, didn't I serve? And Harvey Weinstein's just like chilling.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, there isn't rhyme or reason. You're right. Oh,
it's racist. Criminal justice is racist justice.
Here's some news, a little lighter. Mission Impossible 7 is shut down again because of the coronavirus.
I've been waiting.
Nope, shut down.
Okay, patience impossible. How about that?
Oh, that's probably because Tom Cruise isn't cool with vaccines. It's against Dianetics.
Oh, wait.
You know what? I didn't think of that because I'm like, wait, on an expensive set with such a huge budget, wouldn't everybody just be vaccinated or they can't come on?
When he was talking to Matt Lauer, who, again, free, he was saying, yeah, I don't believe in medicine, but you're being glib, kind of putting me down, say I'm not a doctor. I know about the body. I know about doctoring and that we shouldn't be taking these vaccines. So he's saying be safe on the set, but don't mess with the vaccine. Just be a part all the time.
In Scientology, like, how does he trust that anybody's telling him anything real? You know what I mean? Right. Like, if I was working for Tom Cruise in Scientology, like, I'd just hit him with the vaccine and I'd be like, that's your B12 vitamin.
Right. I guarantee he takes B12. Yeah. You know, those guys take B12.
I mean, right, you know, up the butthole is the way to do it.
Yeah. No, he does that.
Direct in the starfish is like,
just trick them a little bit. Yeah. I don't think anything's wrong with that. I think you're doing everybody a
service. Really, like a whole organization that's like, we know better than you. Are they really going to tell you, man?
Right. Yeah. No, I agree. I like that. No, people can't be trusted. You got to think for them sometimes. You want to do yourself the favor. You want to follow Zahra online. Okay. On Twitter, right. Instagram. You go to Zahra, Z-A-H-R-A comedy.
Go you'll there.
See, you'll see. You'll go there. You'll
Did somebody have Zahra.com?
Zahra dot maybe.
Mm. I'm
just Zahra.com?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I didn't try for Zahra.
Oh, you didn't try it? Oh, okay.
No. I that was too risky. I felt like folks needed a word they recognized.
All right.
The word.
Well, this is spelled wrong. Oh, it's deliberate.
Calm down. It's okay. I got you. We're gonna sound it out. What's that H? It's okay. I'm here.
Are you
comedy's next?
Are you coming back to doing things comedy wise? Is the world opening up?
Is the world opening up? I'm still in denial. I still am just like, okay, are we going to have to deal with another surge, another strain? Where's the other shoe going to drop? The diaspora muscle memory. There's always bad news. Okay. But I am performing. I'm starting to say yes to live shows again.
Okay.
Getting out there to hang out with folks. Book me.
And if you don't, I won't be too offended, but everybody wants to be asked.
I'll be offended. I'll cancel you. I'm gonna get my woke warrior army.
Your shirt says cancel the cancel culture. Now, are you nervous like people could misunderstand that or something, or you know what I mean?
People can't read it.
Just look at my tits.
People can't read it. They want to look at my tits. Cancels on my tits. Below that, they don't see anything. They see cancel tits.
They see cancel and then the bottom of an eye chart.
Yeah. They ask me, why do you want to cancel your tits? Nobody reads it.
All right. So nice meeting you. Thanks a lot for your time. I appreciate it.
Thank you for this playtime. 5 scallops.
And that's it.
Awesome. Thank you so much. Thank that was you. So fun.
Very Let's be fun. Best friends.
Yeah.
I don't know which one you're talking to, but done. Let's go for a drive sometime, but you better start yapping. Yeah.
And I'll know what to say if you're quiet. Which
don't tell on me. like these kids even want to talk, period. Like they don't.
I know.
They don't want to be. They don't want you to talk. It was a blessing I didn't talk to you. Oh, God. Oh, well.
What if she was like covering for you, though?
Yeah, I didn't even think of that. Yeah.
It's like, we didn't talk about marijuana.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Like she's going in there like, huh? No, in fact, he didn't talk to me at all. So yeah. I thought he was rude, actually. But Keith, you were being really rude. Like, maybe right. it is like, a sitcom.
Yeah, she had to turn it into being rude. That's how she covered for me. I was rude.
Zara's right. Zara's right.
How about just say it was a car ride, Ma? Ma, why are you making it a big deal like you do every fucking thing? Why didn't you say that? It's a car ride, dummy. Okay, what do you think we did? How about you talk to her like you normally do? No, he's a dickhead. That's the covering up.
You did that thing in like every sitcom that's like, you know, okay, we're not going to discuss the murder. All right, we agree. And then they right. walk out and they're like, well, and you're like, oh, you're just going to tell him about the murder? You're just going to tell him about the dead body? Right.
Or like walk in and go, no, we didn't murder anyone. Fuck, nobody asked you anything. Holy shit. Right. Oh my God.
Oh, well.
So good. I want to be in your family.
You're just in it for the scallops.
I think you just want to see what I look like driving. I don't blame you. I don't blame you.
It's so hot when you drive.
It's hot so when you shale the driveway, and it's hot when you paint.
When y'all let me stay with you rent free, it's so hot.
I get so turned on.
It's so hot.
Dinner and tip. Oh, that look in your face when you pay dinner and tip. All right. Yeah. Thanks again. Well, how fun was Zara?
Really, really loved her. What did you think?
Zara June was a hit right off the bat. And yeah. Everything went smoothly, which brings me to this. The other day we had on Julia Scotti. The documentary that she was in was called Funny That Way.
That she stars in.
Yes. And you see the forms are blowing up. Was Keith out of line? Was he too much? Same with Keith and the girl being on Reddit. People have opinions. We got an email from her people.
Yeah, this is actually how we booked her. Not everybody's booked directly. We booked her through her people. I believe they were like, hey, how about having her on?
Hi, Keith and the girl podcast team. I just spoke with the Julia Scotti Funny That Way film team and received some disturbing feedback about the interview with Julia Scotti. From what I'm told, one of the hosts, Keith, I believe, went way out of line asking about genitalia, breasts, and some other totally unbelievable, insensitive, and out of limits material. Julia did say the girl was lovely, was married to a trans man, and they had a good chat. But when Keith came on, after he had lost his connection earlier, he barreled into stuff that was highly uncomfortable. Please advise on the above, and I'm looking forward to your reply. Best. You know what? Monday, let's do last week on Keith and the Girl. We'll see you then.
Let's chat this up with Karen.
KeithandtheGirl.com